Christian Science. This age is reaching out towards the perfect principle of things, is pushing towards perfection in art, invention, and manufacture. Why then should religion be stereotyped, and we not obtain a more perfect and practical Christianity? It will never do to be behind the times in things most essential, which proceed from the standard of right that regulates human destiny. Human skill but foreshadows what is next to appear as its divine origin. Proportionately as we part with material systems and theories, personal doctrines and dogmas, meekly to ascend the hill of science, shall we reach the maximum of perfection in all things. Spirit is omnipotent. Hence, a more spiritual Christianity will be one having more power, having perfected in science that most important of all arts, healing. Metaphysical healing, or Christian Science, is a demand of the times. Every man and every woman would desire and demand it, if he and she knew its infinite value and firm basis. The unerring and fixed principle of all healing is God, and this principle should be sought from the love of good, from the most spiritual and unselfish motives. Then will it be understood to be of God and not of man, and this will prevent mankind from striking out promiscuously, teaching and practicing in the name of science without knowing its fundamental principle. It is important to know that a malpractice of the best system will result in the worst form of medicine. Moreover, the feverish, disgusting pride of those who call themselves metaphysicians or scientists, but are such in name only, fanned by the breath of mental malpractice, is the death's head at the feast of truth, the monkey in harlequin jacket that will retard the onward march of life-giving science, if not understood and withstood, and so strangled in its attempts. The standard of metaphysical healing is traduced by thinking to put into the old garment of drugging the new cloth of metaphysics, or by trying to twist the fatal magnetic force of mortal mind, termed hypnotism, into a more fashionable cut and naming that mind cure, or, which is still worse in the eyes of truth, terming it metaphysics. Substituting good words for a good life, fair seeming for straightforward character, mental malpractice for the practice of true medicine, is a poor shift for the weak and worldly who think the standard of Christian science too high for them. What think you of a scientist in mathematics who finds fault with the exactness of the rule because unwilling to work hard enough to practice it? The perfection of the rule of Christian science is what constitutes its utility, having a true standard. If some fall short, others will approach it, and these are they only who adhere to that standard. Matter must be understood as a false belief or product of mortal mind, whence we learn that sensation is not in matter, but in this so-called mind, that we see and feel disease only by reason of our belief in it. Then shall matter remain no longer to blind us to spirit and clog the wheels of progress. We spread our wings in vain when we attempt to mount above error by speculative views of truth. Love is the principle of divine science, and love is not learned of the material senses, nor gained by a culpable attempt to seem what we have not lifted ourselves to be, namely, a Christian. In love for man, we gain a true sense of love as God, and in no other way can we reach this spiritual sense and rise, and still rise, to things most essential and divine. What hinders man's progress is his vain conceit, the Phariseeism of the times, also his effort to steal from others and avoid hard work, errors which can never find a place in science. Empirical knowledge is worse than useless. It never has advanced man a single step in the scale of being. That one should have ventured on such unfamiliar ground and, self-forgetful, should have gone on to establish this mighty system of metaphysical healing called Christian Science against such odds, even the entire current of mortality, is matter of grave wonderment to profound thinkers. That, in addition to this, she has made some progress, has seen far into the spiritual facts of being which constitute physical and mental perfection, in the midst of an age so sunken in sin and sensuality, seems to them still more inconceivable. In this new departure of metaphysics, God is regarded more as absolute, supreme, and Christ is clad with a richer illumination as our Savior from sickness, sin, and death. God's fatherliness as life, truth, and love makes his sovereignty glorious. By this system, too, man has changed recognition of his relation to God. He is no longer obliged to sin, be sick, and die to reach heaven, but is required and empowered to conquer sin, sickness, and death. Thus, as image and likeness, to reflect him who destroys death and hell. By this reflection, man becomes the partaker of that mind whence sprang the universe. In Christian Science, progress is demonstration, not doctrine. This science is ameliorative and regenerative, delivering mankind from all error through the light and love of truth. It gives to the race loftier desires and new possibilities. It lays the axe at the root of the tree of knowledge to cut down all that bringeth not forth good fruit. And blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended in me. It touches mind to more spiritual issues, systematizes action, gives a keener sense of truth, and a stronger desire for it. Hungering and thirsting after a better life, we shall have it and become Christian Scientists, learn God aright, and know something of the ideal man, the real man, harmonious and eternal. This movement of thought must push on the ages. It must start the wheels of reason aright, educate the affections to higher resources, and leave Christianity unbiased by the superstitions of a senior period.